finally, the third part of the Law of Moses was the social or civil part. Like our own civil laws, this set the ground rules on how people were to interact with one another, resolve disputes, and generally create a stable and harmonious society. If the ceremonial part of the law kept people right with God, then the social part of the law kept people right with each other. The social part of the law also involved instructions on neutral things. For example, it stated that every 7 years farmland should be rested so that it remained productive with food. Every 7 years all debts were to be cancelled and reset too. And if you'll allow me to go off on a slight tangent on that, one of the accusations often levelled at the Old Testament is that it condones slavery. The truth is that while it's true that people could put themselves into slavery to pay off a debt to another, the social part of the law insisted that all debts had to be cancelled and slaves had to be freed every 7th year. So this wasn't slavery in the way we think of it today. It's a bit like when you can't pay a restaurant bill, so you spend the evening doing unpaid labour, like washing the dishes to pay off the debt. People who had come into poverty and who couldn't pay their bills could put themselves under the ownership of another doing unpaid work to pay off a debt, but the owner was commanded by law to release that person back into freedom within 7 years. There were also firm instructions to treat the slave more like a temporary worker or house help rather than a slave. Harsh treatment was strictly forbidden. Every 50 years there was also to be what's known as the Year of Jubilee, and this was a celebration that also involved the resetting of debts and freeing of slaves. To read about some of the clever ideas in the social part of the law, turn to Leviticus chapter 25. So each part of the law interacted. The moral part was designed to reveal how morally bankrupt the people were in the eyes of God, and then the idea was that they would then be driven towards the ceremonial part with its rituals to atone for their sin. The shedding of blood would be a potent reminder of the severity of their wrongdoing before a holy God, and it would introduce them to the idea that another could pay the price for their sins. And then the social part of the law would keep people right with one another and maintain a stable and harmonious society. But even though I've just been talking about the Law of Moses as though it had three distinct parts, and although it's common for teachers to divide it like that for the purpose of analysis, it's important to realise that the Law of Moses is actually a single and indivisible unit. All 613 rules functioned as one, and I can't stress that enough. In Basic Theology, Charles C. Riney states, "The Jewish people either did not acknowledge the threefold division, or at least did not insist on it. Rather, they divided the 613 commandments of the law into 12 families of commandments, which were then subdivided into 12 additional families of positive and 12 additional families of negative commands. Because there is no division between the types of laws, they actually sit side by side and run on from one another in the Bible. For example, in Leviticus 19:13 we read, 'Do not defraud or rob your neighbor,' which is a moral command against theft. But then running straight on from that we read, 'Do not make your hired workers wait until the next day to receive their pay,' which is a social law. There's no obvious distinction or separation between the two types of law in the text. It was a complete unit." What this meant is that if someone broke one of the 613 rules of the law, they broke the whole unit. If they kept 612 of the rules but broke the 613th, they were guilty of breaking the entire thing, and it didn't matter which category of law they broke because it all functioned as one. Our civil law works in the same way. The British government says that murder is illegal, and that's a moral law, but the British government also says not to break the speed limit, and that's not a moral law, it's a social one. It's not any more immoral to drive at 51 miles per hour than it is at 50. But whether someone murders or breaks the speed limit, we use the same expression for both. We say that they have broken the law, singular. The same authority, namely the British government, has been offended by each transgression. It's the same with the Law of Moses. Whichever one of the 613 you broke, whether it be moral or ceremonial or social, it was an offence to the same authority, God. And because of his holiness, God punishes all sin the same way, by death. Now imagine if someone was caught breaking the speed limit and then pleaded their case in front of a human judge by saying, "Well, yes, I was speeding, but I haven't murdered anyone, so I think you should let me off without any punishment." The judge would say, "It's good you haven't murdered anyone, but you have still broken the law, and therefore I have to punish you for the crime you have committed." In other words, you can't atone for breaking one law by keeping all the other laws. If you break one, whichever one it is, you are deserving of punishment. In the same way, the people of Israel couldn't say to God, "Yes, I have broken one law, but I've kept all the other 612, so I don't deserve punishment." God would say, "It's good you've kept 612 of the laws, but I still have to punish you for the one that you have broken. You have still sinned." And under the law of Moses, the punishment for all sin was death. What I'm trying to communicate here is that if there is a law, the only way to fully satisfy it is to keep it perfectly, and if you don't satisfy it to the last detail, you are deserving of punishment. For Israel, all sin meant death, so even keeping 612 of the laws and breaking just one would mean death because of the purity of God. In other words, someone who broke some of the laws was actually in no better shape than someone who broke them all. They would both be under the same curse of death. The Bible says, "Cursed is anyone who does not affirm and obey the terms of these instructions." So if we can be stark about it, the law of Moses actually put everyone under a curse of death, because literally not a single person could keep all of the 613 rules perfectly. Here's another way of looking at it. If you take an exam and the pass mark is 50%, it doesn't matter whether you get 49% or 4%, both grades will cause you to fail. The person getting 49%, although they are closer to the pass mark, actually has no advantage over the person who only got 4%. Both have failed. Now, God's moral requirement was actually 100% perfection. Even one sin would lead to death, and since no human is capable of perfection, it doesn't matter whether they were quite good, say 99% good or 1% good. Everyone was under the curse of death. This was simply the point of the law of Moses then, to show the people that they fell short of God's perfect moral standard and that without the sacrificial shedding of blood for their sins, they themselves would die.